My name is Simone Spuler, and I'm a neurologist by training, and I'm the head of a research group here at the ECRC, an institute for translational research that is maintained by the Charité as well as the Max Delbrück Center for Molecular Medicine, and we are interested in muscle sciences.
My name is Helena Escobar, and I'm a postdoc in the lab of Simone Spuler at the Experimental and Clinical Research Center in Berlin. I am working on gene and cell therapy for genetic muscle disease.
We are interested in muscle wasting, and in particular in genetically caused muscular dystrophies. And this is a group of several diseases, about 40 different, and they are all quite severe and there's no treatment available yet. But the advances of molecular genetics, and in particular of CRISPR-Cas technology and of stem cell biology, really makes it possible to hope for a change in the perspective for these diseases.
In this study, we have obtained primary human muscle stem cells from a patient that is affected by a genetic muscle disease that is called limb girdle muscular dystrophy, type 2D or type R3. The patient has a mutation in a gene called alpha-sarcoglycan. We saw that this mutation was a very good candidate for a method that is called adenine-based editing. We aimed to correct this mutation using CRISPR-Cas9-based methods in the muscle stem cells from the patient. What is different about classical CRISPR and base editing is that CRISPR acts more like a DNA scissor. Cas9 is brought onto the DNA by a small RNA molecule, and there it cuts the DNA at the desired position. And then the cell needs to repair this, this DNA cut, and the cell can use different pathways to do so. And sometimes the cell does not repair the DNA cut as we would like to. However, base editing is more, if you envision a forceps, so that there is no cut in the DNA. Instead, Cas9 is only used as a navigator to bring another protein onto the target position. And this protein just does a small and very precise modification. We first obtain the muscle stem cells from the patient using methods that have been developed in the lab over the past 10 years. And then we transfected these muscle stem cells with a plasmid that contains the coding sequence for the adenine base editor and a suitable single guide RNA. We then analyzed the cells that had been transfected to see whether we could see correction of the a repair of the mutation at the genomic level, and after we saw that the cells had been effectively repaired using adenine-based editing, we then set out to see whether the gene repair would also lead to a reconstitution of the alpha-sarcoglycan protein that was initially missing in those cells. And so we saw that the cells that had been corrected were re-expressing alpha-sarcoglycan to normal levels. And then we wanted to know whether the cells that had been corrected would also keep their myogenic properties and whether they could also give rise to muscle. So we first utilized the fusion assay in vitro to see that those cells could form multinucleated myotubes in the cell culture dish. And then we also transplanted those cells into immunosuppressed mice, where we saw that those cells were able to also generate myofibers of human origin in the mouse muscles. And we also saw that those cells were also not only giving rise to human myofibers, but they could also actually reconstitute the muscle stem cell compartment. So they could give rise to new gene-repaired muscle stem cells in the muscle. And the presence of both myofibers of human origin as well as muscle stem cells of human origin in the grafted muscle is an indicator that the therapeutic effect could last for a longer time. This is a really interesting finding because it tells us that we can extract human muscle stem cells and repair them ex vivo and transplant them maybe in the future into patients to try to reconstitute the function of muscles which are degenerated due to genetic muscle disease.
There are super important or very important muscles that are crucial for some sort of independence, like the finger flexors. If you are able to hold your cup, to brush your teeth, to do all kinds of important things with your hands, you are much more independent than people who cannot use their finger flexors. Or think about swallowing. Swallowing muscles are quite small and they can be reconstituted, and this has already been shown in a disease where these muscles are particularly affected, and this really makes a difference whether the patient can eat or cannot eat. The very big next step would be to transform the knowledge we have now for correcting cells to do an in vivo gene correction.
Even though limb girdle muscular dystrophies are rare diseases, cumulatively there are a lot of patients who are affected, and we work on very translational projects, and we have a very strong drive to bring these projects forward to be able to in the future help those patients, and we do our best.